So we move on from system virtualization to storage virtualization. So the four parts of this particular module are, what is the system interface? What is the storage interface? So basically, there are terms like SCSI and fiber channel that I will explain what they are, and what is meant by storage area network, how do you virtualize them, and then what is the difference between SAN and NAS. So in the data centers, you don't put disk inside a computer just like you do on your desktop. Internal disks are not very helpful because, if the system goes, the disk goes with it, and what good is it, right? So you want to keep the disk external. So all the disks are put into a disk array. And then everybody connects to it somehow. So the disk array has generally two controllers. All the disks are connected to both controllers, and similarly the computers connect by two ways to the controller. Just like the switches and the other thing we saw. This way, if any controller goes away or if any host goes away, the information is all still there. Okay? And this is just the opposite of what we would call JBODs. JBODs means just a bunch of disks. Just a bunch of disks is what we do at home and, you know, in other places where we really don't have any organization of the disk. We have a whole bunch of disks that we connect and disconnect and put here and there. So that is JBOD. So in data centers, we don't use JBODs. We use disk arrays. All right? And there are three ways we access these disks. Either block access, which means we tell them that please read this sector number, that number, you know, so on and so forth. Block size is defined generally by number of sectors. Each sector is generally 512 bytes. You might read, you know, 4, 16, 64, any numbers of clusters like that, generally powers of 2s. And at a time, and then you just go block by block by block. And that is most common. Second thing which we might do is the file access, where the file is actually just a virtualization of the blocks, because we don't want to read blocks. I mean, in our daily work, generally what we do is we put things into files. So file is just for your viewing. The disk don't understand file. Disk only understand blocks, right? So there is something in between you and the disk that translates the files into blocks, which is generally the operating system. So the operating system knows for each file what block number it begins and where does it go. So there is a whole linked list of blocks that the file contains. And then the file also has metadata such as what date it was created, when it was modified, how long it is, and what, you know, all those things, what extension it has. But the disk don't care, right? You understand that part? The disk, all they have is some blocks and blocks and blocks. So right there is the virtualization. So the files may not be contiguous, and you need a file system which is either FAT32, NTFS, or, you know, there are many other names that you know in Unix world, right? And the, so that is basically how the, you know, an operating system basically use that particular system, however they have designed, to reach the files. The third method is record access. If you have a database, then the databases are arranged by records. So every person, every customer, every entity, every equipment has a record in the database, and you may want to reach that record. Again, record is some kind of overlay on the top of the blocks, just like file system says, but in the database world, instead of having files, they will rather read records. Okay? And then there are, just like NTFS and things like that, there are database languages such as SQL, Structured Query Language, or Open Database Connectivity, ODBC, or Java Database Connectivity, JDBC. These are the things that are used to access those records. And so basically, block access is really what you would call, you know, real access. And then everything else is virtual. Even block access could be virtual, in the sense that You will say, well, I want to read block number 243, but something translates that into disk number, and on that disk, where that block is. All right? So while you might think that there is a whole contiguous big disk, but that may not be a big disk, there might be a little disk behind it. Okay? So the storage people have been doing virtualization for a long time, long before the computing people, I mean, long before the server people. Any question about that? All right. So the first disks that we sort of remember, you know, I mean, they were, I must have been old before that because they talk about drum disks, which I never used. But disks were SCSI disks. SCSI stands for SCSI, Small Computer System Interface. You connected one disk, and then from that disk connected the second disk and third disk. You could daisy chain as many, you know, basically 16 or 8 or some number of the disks. And it was parallel. So 8 to 16 devices on a bus, any number of hosts on the bus. So, I mean, those are 8 or 10, 16 connection point. You could have some disk and some host. So the bus is shared by many hosts and many disks. Generally, this is theoretically this possible, but generally each bus was just basically connected to one host and multiple disks. And I'm seeing all in the past tense because we don't use SCSI physically as such right now. I mean, as far as I know, but they might be used in the background, which I don't see. Okay, so they might be there. So it's peer to peer. So you could even go from one disk to the other disk. You know, if the disk was smart enough, it could ask for data, but generally disks are not that smart, so you generally read to the host and write back to some other disk. They are peer-to-peer, host-to-device, device-to-device, and host-to-host. All kinds of APIs are there, but most devices simply implement targets. Targets means they are, you know, another word is slaves, in the sense that they just listen. They don't order. The only person who can order is the host. Host is the initiator. Okay? Each device has a SCSI bus has an ID. So the devices are numbered, you know, you have ID 1, ID 0, ID 5, ID 6, ID 7, and when on the bus a command comes that please, device number 0, please read your sector number such and such. Alright, so there is an ID. And each device may have multiple logical units inside it. So there is another level of virtualization right there, is that you think it is one disk, but inside the disk there might be multiple disks. And they are called logical units. LUNs. Logical unit number is LUN. Logical unit number. And each LUN has what we call blocks, and the blocks have LBA, the logical block address. And each logical block is typically 512 bytes, which is a sector. Initially used the parallel interface, so SCSI was mostly parallel, and the problem with the parallel interfaces is that you cannot make them run very fast. The problem with the running very fast on a parallel track is that if 10 people are running in parallel and one person is slightly slow for whatever reason, the bits get all mixed up at the end. Difficult to synchronize. So it's better that only one person runs. So most of the things today we do are serial. In fact, most of the time we use the bus called USB. USB stands for what? Universal Serial Bus. And it goes very fast, and it's going faster every day. And same thing for other disk devices. The disk storage is all becoming serial. So there is a serial SCSI. It's called SAS, Serial Attached SCSI, which is higher speed. Okay? So this is only historical. Actually, the parallel SCSI is mostly historical. I still have box full of SCSI cables and maybe devices, but they are so slow and so small in terms of the volume that I haven't touched them for years now. All right, the next thing that came after SCSI was ATA. ATA. So basically, Advanced Technology Attachment, it was designed for PCs. So when IBM came up with the PC idea, they came up with a new disk idea, and that disk was called PATA, P-A-T-A, Parallel ATA. Okay, so this was parallel even then, 1986. However, the smart thing in this case was that the disk was smarter than before, and therefore it has an electronics built into it. So it was not just magnetic media, but there was some little microprocessor in it. And so that was called Integrated Device Electronics, IDE. So many of you at least have seen IDE disk. Has anybody heard IDE disk? Right, IDE. So IDEs were there. I mean, IDEs are not that old. IDEs actually are even newer than SCSI. And then they gave you about 133 megabits using parallel ribbon cables. And then a interface was extended so that it also could include CD-ROMs, DVD-ROMs, and tape drives, and that was called AT-API. So this is interface extension. By the way, all of these are ANSI standards. SCSI is, and ATA is, and everything else is. So this AT-API is a extension so that, you know, it's not just the disk, it could also be applied to CD-ROMs and tape drives. And then came serial ATA, serial SATA. Now, SATA drives are what we use today. All right? Everybody knows that, agrees that, right? When you buy, it says SATA 1, SATA 2, SATA 3, SATA 4, whatever it is. So they started with 6 gigabit, and now they go up from there. But they are serial. Okay, if you look at the cable, there are only 4 cables in this, or something like that, very small number of cables, and so some of them might be for control or something like that. And the thing is, one thing which this ANSI committee follows is that every time they extend something, they just extend the number. So you have ATA, ATA2, ATA3, ATA4, like that. Those are just the version numbers. Similarly, SATA has SATA 1, SATA 2, SATA 3, and I think right now we are up to SATA 3, maybe 6, I don't know, but 3 is what I have used for sure. And then there is eSATA, which is external SATA. So if you want to connect a SATA device, many computers come with eSATA port. You can connect them externally. And there's the mSATA, mini SATA, which is even takes less than what SATA takes. SATA is already very small to begin with. But anyway, so that is the current technology for general use in your home and business. Right? Everybody understand the SATA part? I mean, everybody has used the SATA disk. Any disk that you have right now on your computer is actually a SATA disk. Okay, so. But let's go back to the mainframes and data center in a minute. So mainframes, while we were using SATA and all that, mainframes were using SCON and FICON. SCON is the Enterprise System Connection, which was designed. But by the way, IBM has been a leader in this field, so you will see IBM's name everywhere, all the way from beginning to the end. So IBM actually designed the first storage drummed memories. When we had the first disk, it was designed by IBM. When we had the second disk, it was designed by IBM, and so on and so forth. So, you know, that is the case. Just like VMware in the virtualization world, IBM in the disk world. So SCON is Enterprise System Interconnection. It was designed for mainframes. And the new thing here was that you could connect it to a switch. At that way, you could connect to multiple computers and multiple disks on this side. So you could have a switch in between. This was the invention. And they used fiber on this, and the fiber allowed 17 megabits for a long distance. So you could take, you know, to long place in a data center. But it is half duplex. Anybody knows what is half duplex? Go ahead. Yeah, so it is one-way street. I mean, basically one-way in the sense that it's not really one-way. It's like when you are construction on the road, only one part will go, you go either this way or go that way. But, you know, so that is half duplex. What is it that is one-way, totally one-way? That is called what?
Simplex.
Simplex. All right. So, and the other word is full duplex. So we have three ways: full duplex, simplex, and half duplex. So this is half duplex. Did I change? This is half duplex, that means you could just go one way or the other. And then they designed fiber connectivity, FICON, which did one more thing. It just not only allowed a switch, it allows a network of switches. All right? And then obviously they had single byte commands. And the single byte commands actually are coming from the days of SCSI. SCSI takes commands which are just 1 byte long. In 1 byte, you can say whether you want to read, write, delete, whatever you want to do on that sector. And so they had single byte command set, and they used fiber channel as a transport. So whatever they used as a transport, they proposed that as a standard, and that was selected as a standard, and it's called fiber channel. Now, fiber here is spelled different than the fiber everywhere else. You see fibers here and the fiber here, two different spellings. This is in American spelling, and this is European spelling. Okay? Or you can call it English spelling. So there is US and English, and the reason the fiber channel name uses English spelling or the European spelling, because that is where it came from. The IBM Europe must have designed it. Okay? So throughout this paper, you will see two spellings, and that is consistent with the whole literature. When you use fiber in for any other use, it is F-I-B-E-R. When you use it for fiber channel, it is F-I-B-R-E. Okay? So fiber channel is a name, so that's why it is, you know, basically it's a pronoun as opposed to a noun, so it has to be capitalized and it has to be spelled the way they spelled it. So we talk about fiber channel. Fiber channel, again, everything is ANSI standard. Now ANSI, interestingly enough, even though the fiber channel started in Europe, was standardized in America. ANSI is American. American National Standard Institute. It's not ISO. From ANSI, it goes to ISO. So then it becomes worldwide. But it's an ANSI standard. So all the standards that we are going to talk about throughout this lecture are ANSI standards, and they're all done by T11. So ANSI has many, many groups, just like IEEE has 802 and so on and so forth. They have T11, T10, T9. T11 does this part, and so they standardize fiber channel for storage area network. So this is already a network now. And so there are three parts. There are host, there is a storage, and there is a network. And that is network, by the way, they don't call it network, they call it fabric. Like fabric, like is a cloth. You know, you just very tightly knit. So this is a fiber channel fabric. There is a host and there is a storage. The fabric may consist of any kind of connection. Actually, you know, basically there are some connections that will be recommended, but basically lots of switches interconnected. And then you have the storage, which is the disk arrays, as we talked about, with a controller. So the arrays are connected to the fabric, and fabric is connected to the host. Now with this arrangement, any host can reach any disk in spite of all the failures. Fiber channel runs at 2, 4, 8, 16, 32 gigabits. It can run on copper or fiber. It allows point-to-point arbitrated loop and the switched fabric. So point-to-point arbitrated loop or switched fabric. Either way is allowed. Switch fabric, I have shown you a very simple configuration, but it could be any network of switches. Okay? And loop is simply you go around and around and around and around. A ring. And this is a node. It's back and forth. So, now, by the time fiber channel was being developed, Ethernet was already here, so there are lots of give and take in the sense that there are several ideas from Ethernet that were taken by fiber channel, and now there are several ideas from fiber channel that have been taken up by Ethernet. So you will see some kind of, you know, similarity between the two because the same people are working on both. So the host adapter have a 64 worldwide name. So Ethernet computers and devices have 48-bit worldwide unique name. Right? That is called MAC address. It's globally unique. But these guys were not happy with 64-bit, so they added 16 more bit to it. Sorry, they were not happy with 48-bit, so they added 16 more bits to it, making a total of 48 plus 16, 64-bit. And the first 16 bits that were added could be different depending upon who gave you that address. In the case of Ethernet, all addresses come from IEEE. Suppose you start a new Ethernet company tomorrow, which we did actually in our lifetime, in my lifetime I did. So what you have to do is you have to go to IEEE and write a letter saying that I need an Ethernet address block, and you pay $1,000 and you get a real nice big block, 2-24 addresses. And then when you make a device, one by one you number them. So your first device has this MAC address, second device has 02, 0001, 0010, 0011, and so on until you run out of them, and then you say, I need another one for $1,000. It's very cheap. All right. However, it will become short in supply soon when the Internet of Things comes in, but that's a little bit away. 48 bits are good enough. So right now they're available for very cheap, available for asking. So that is called OUI. OUI is Organizationally Unique Identifier. This is what IEEE gives you. Okay? And then you can add VSID, which is the vendor specific. VSID is not virtual. Vendor specific ID. This is the number that you just put on every device one after another. So sequential number, VSID. And in the beginning is who gave you that OUI. And so other people could give you, it's not IEEE, it could be given by ISO or somebody else. And so that number, so there are different schemes, and those go here in the first four bits will tell you who gave it. If the first four bit is one, then somebody gave you. If the first four bit is two, then somebody else gave you. And actually, I think this picture is slightly wrong because the whole thing has to add up to 64 bit. So there are 12 bits which I didn't plot here. So there, before OUI, please put 12 bits. No, sorry, 12 bits are here. Okay. So 36 plus 24 plus 4 is 64. So that's fine. So if this organization gave you, then your 36 bit VSID as opposed to IEEE, which is 24 bit VSID. Yeah.
So I was, do you have any reason why
Yeah, because they decided, first of all, two reasons. First of all, they didn't want to be logged into IEEE. They're not IEEE. They are ANSI. Right? So they already have to go to some other organization to get the address, and that is not a good idea. Second thing is, if they want to be really, I mean, this could happen to Ethernet too, but it didn't happen to Ethernet. But basically, when it goes to ISO, everybody wants to have control over what goes on. So ISO would want to have control over who gives the addresses and how they're given, to whom they're given. You know, see, the thing in IPv4, there was a lot of unfairness. Everybody knows that, right? Some countries got a lot of addresses, some countries didn't get the address, and some country controlled the addresses, some country controls this and that. I mean, you know all this story, right? So in this case, if there are multiple people who are giving the addresses out, we have to distinguish. So we need some bits for them. So they felt adding 12 more bits and then adding 4 bits for the entity that gave you the address would be sufficient. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So anyway, we got 64-bit addresses. They call it worldwide names. They don't call it MAC address. They don't call it fiber channel address. They call it WWN. Worldwide name. All right. And you know what is VSID, right? Vendor specific ID, that is a sequential number that is given by the vendor. And the devices actually are like this. What happens is you have on the computer itself, there's a slot which says fiber channel, but it is empty. There's nothing in it. The reason there's nothing in it is because you may want to connect single mode fiber or multi-mode fiber or this fiber or that fiber. Fiber comes in many different varieties. And for each of them, you need a different kind of receiver. Unlike copper, where you can just plug in and then decide, you know, whether you want to receive it at gigabit or megabit or whatever, right? In fiber, the receiver is different for different kinds of fiber. So you cannot just plug in something and then the customer will find out that they have a different kind of fiber, right? So they let the customer put it in, and that is called GBIC. Gigabit Interface Converter. This is a GBIC. So you buy the computer, you buy the switch, and then you buy the GBICs to suit your cabling. You cannot change the cabling very easily. If you have cabled this building with single mode fiber, you can just put a single mode GBIC. Okay? And then you bring the fiber in, fiber comes connectorized, so the connectors go straight in, and so it's very easy to plug in. And hubs. So now the switches and the hubs. The hubs is a physical layer device, just like an Ethernet hub. It's a physical layer device. It's like an active patch panel. Multiple host or storage devices can be connected to a hub, but only one host can talk to one device at a time. So, I mean, you can connect many things to a hub. Inside the hub, there is a kind of a ring. So, basically, it's just like a ring configuration where only one host can talk to second host. When one is talking to the second one, third, fourth, fifth cannot talk. Okay? That is FCAL. That is the fiber channel arbitrated loop. Our switches. Switches is a link layer device, and they forward the frame control frames. They are the fiber channel frames according to destination address. So just like an Ethernet switch, they look at the destination address, where it is going, which port this would get out, which port they came in, thing like that. Alright? And then you have routers and gateways which do higher layer stuff as to connect to some other kind of network, another kind of device to speak some other kind of interconnection like SCSI or whatever. So the key thing is to know about the switches. And any question about this slide? None? By the way, there will be quiz every day. So there will be quiz on Monday again. You know, this is just a constant feature now. Fiber channel protocol layers. So now, just like Ethernet and IP, they have a protocol layer, which is five layers, but they do not follow ISO model. So it's difficult to say where is what. Their first layer is cable, second layer is encoding. What is encoding? Encoding is when you give one bit, the question is how does it look on the wire? Alright? First of all, they do 8-bit, 10-bit encoding, which means that they take your 8-bit and convert them into 10 bits. Alright, so that if something, so that way basically they are using only 2^8 combinations out of 2^10 combinations. So right away they find out that this there is an error in this byte because it is an invalid combination. Alright, 25% of the combinations are valid, 75% are invalid. So there's a good chance that they will catch byte in error right there. So that is encoding. Then they have how to send it, to where to send it, and there are three ways, either by doing the switching or by doing arbitrated loop or by doing nothing, basically, which is point to point. Then they have to do things like encryption and RAID, which we'll talk about in a minute, and so that is generic services. And then they have to protocol map to the real device. The real device may be SCSI, maybe IP device, or maybe IBM single byte control command set. Yeah.
So when I want to transport the layer and the application layers, how on the layers?
On the top of it?
Yeah.
See, thing is, you will be starting, this is difficult to say. For you, this is all physical layer, because what you are doing is, maybe IP, if you are using IP, you can come here. But let's say you want to, you really want to connect to an SCSI device. Right? So the SCSI driver on your computer, if it is connected to fiber channel driver there, will somehow form a command in which SCSI command will be sent on the top of this SCSI FCP protocol, which on the top of all this, and will go over the fiber channel network at the other end will come out. So it's difficult to say what is the application layer here.
I mean, when I send a packet to another country, like on that computer, so this is only
disk, this is how it will start from the disk and it will go to the disk. Over there, the reason I'm saying is that application has a different meaning. Here, if you want to call everybody reading a disk as an application, then yes. That will be running on the top of this, on the top which is not shown here.
This is all the kernel. There's an API layer
on the top of this, yeah.
Which applications call? This is a generic API. You just say read and write.
Read and write, yeah. This is just disk I/O, right? And so it all looks familiar, but it's still slightly different. Now, one thing to remember is that encoding is basically is different here. And then second thing is that they have different kinds of topologies, and that the RAID and encryption are part of the protocol layer here. And then, of course, the mapping. And then they use fast, shortest path first. Just like we had ECMP, equal cache multipath, they have equal cache multipath, but they call it FSPF, fiber channel shortest path. So here is the interesting thing, that they came up with the fiber channel fastest path before Ethernet guys adopted it. So first, fiber channel was the first one to use this whole routing thing in their network, and then Ethernet people said, if we are going to do it, why can't we do it too? And so then they said, now it is not just IP which can do routing, Ethernet can do routing too. I mean, we taught you that the data link layer doesn't do routing, right? But that was when we taught you 473. In this course, we're teaching you that Ethernet can do everything. And so can fiber channel. So there is that. Second thing is, just like we talked about SATA 1, SATA 2, SATA 3, all of these protocols have different versions. So if you go to standards and try to find out, you will find FCSW-3, which means the third revision, second revision, first one. So there's a dash and a number which tells you the revision on that standard. And all of these have different revisions. And then the vendor specific equal cost multipath multiplexing. So the thing is, while it allows the shortest path, but if you have more than one shortest path, how do you select? That is not specified in the standard. That is selected by the vendor. So everybody has a different way of selecting how to select them path. Any question on this one? Now this is a complicated slide, and this actually has some chapters filled information here, whole chapter full of information. I just want to keep it at this level, and I don't really expect you to know more than this level, because the thing is, if you don't know what is FCSW, you get caught. You read fiber channel and everywhere they have these words spelt. I mean, they used. At the same time, knowing more detail than this would require a lot more time for you, and it's not really relevant because fiber channel is going away. It is being replaced by Ethernet. The reason I have to teach you fiber channel is because it's still there. It is still there. And Ethernet is changing because of it. So to teach you what change in Ethernet, like for example, you saw the fiber, Ethernet did flow control, right? Ethernet did congestion control. Ethernet did shortest path routing. All of it came from here. All right, flow control. Fiber channel has a very good flow control. They call it credit-based flow control. So you cannot send the packets until the receiver says, please send me. That means the receiver can say, please send me 4 packets, you send 4 packets. Receiver can send me 4 more packets, you send 4 more packets. So basically, receiver has to have the buffers before it can ask you to send, and then you send, and then it has buffers. So it doesn't, no, it is not that you send the packet, it makes all the way to the destination, and the destination drops it. It has no buffers. So this is one of the things that basically works very good for the disk. The disk don't like packets dropped. And the flow control is not one layer, it is 2 layers. You can do it hop by hop, or you can do end to end, or you can do both. All right. Does anybody know where in the real internet, on the wired internet network, not fiber channel, we do hop by hop flow control? Anybody has seen hop by hop flow control? No? Never heard of it? Anybody heard of the end-to-end flow control? Oh my God. This is the problem with nobody taking 473 at WashU, is that this is a basic thing that we teach in 473, end-to-end flow control. Come on now. Which layer or which protocol does end-to-end flow control? Huh? Yeah, so which protocol does it?
TCP
does it. So why don't you say it? So now you said it, but now I'm just saying. TCP is so well known that we do end-to-end flow control in TCP. But there is one more place where we do hop by hop, and that is in the wireless networks. Now some of you have not taken wireless, but at least we teach a little bit of wireless in 473. And there, you know, because the link is so bad that you cannot really rely on the end-to-end, so you do hop by hop. So that's why they allow you both. Then they have classes of service. class 1, class 2, class 3, depending upon how much reliability and you want. And whether you want connection oriented or connection less. Connection oriented is like TCP. Connection less is like UDP. Okay? So connection oriented, dedicated, physical link. So you get a link. So if you get a connection, class 1 service means you are paying for the whole path, whole road. And you get a wire, you get a fiber. Frame order is guaranteed, delay confirmation is there, means delivery confirmation is there, and end-to-end flow control is there. So everything is guaranteed. That is the most expensive service. Less one is the connection less. You have multiple paths, and therefore the packets may come this way, this way, this way, so they will not be guaranteed. The order will not be guaranteed. Hop by hop and end-to-end flow control. Datagram service, which has no delivery confirmation, only hop by hop flow control. This is the most common one. And then connection-oriented virtual circuit, where you get a part of the link. Here you get full link, here you get virtual circuit. So this is a physical dedicated circuit, this is a virtual circuit. So you get a piece of the link, piece of the fiber, with delivery confirmation. And then 5 is not defined. 6 is connection-oriented multicast with delivery confirmation. So this is for multicast, all of these are for unicast. And then class F, which is packet switch delivery with confirmation for inter-switch communication only. So this is not end-to-end, this is between the switches. All right, because they do have class F, I believe they probably have 4 bits for the classes, and so they would go from 0 through F, 16 classes. All right, now in Ethernet, we have classes, you saw, priorities have been replaced by classes. And how many classes we have there? How many classes in Ethernet?
8 classes.
8 classes, right. Okay, we have to go back one more lecture for the quiz. All right. So what is storage virtualization? So I'm going to restate. We already saw this definition before, and I'm going to restate in terms of the disk. So Rick Van der Lans didn't say this, but he just said virtualization, and I am adding a storage word here. Storage virtualization means that applications can use storage without any concerns for where it resides, what technical interface is, whether it is SCSI or SATA, we don't care, and how it has been implemented, whether it is in disk array or just bunch of disk or whatever, what platform it is, and so on and so forth, or how much it is available. If you do that, that is this storage virtualization. And so basically, with the storage virtualization, the distance doesn't matter. Remote storage devices appear local, the size doesn't matter, smaller disk appear big, spread doesn't matter, whether it is one disk or multiple disk, you can't tell the difference. File system doesn't matter, whether it has been stored on Windows, Linux or Unix, you don't know. Virtual interface, so basically you could think that looks like a SCSI, but it is no SCSI. And the advantage is that high availability, disaster recovery, improved performance, everything else, you know, that we talked about virtualization. So we apply all that to storage. Right, and so talking about the benefits, which is just restating the previous things, you can go much longer distances, you can get much longer, much better performance, you can get much better disk utilization, you get higher availability with multiple access paths and higher performance because of multiple access paths, higher availability due to redundant storage, so you will have, you can write on 2 disks while you need to write only on 1. Disaster recovery capability, if something happens, you know, you still have the data saved from other places, other copies. Continuous online backup. I think I missed the word up, so please write it down. Backup. Easier testing, increasable scalability. Scalability means that you have 1 gigabyte and you want to make it 10 gigabyte and 1 terabyte and 15 terabyte, and you can just do that in the background. Not to worry about it. Allow thin provisioning, which means that you could just have 1 gigabit disk while the customer thinks that they have 10 gigabit disk. Right? This is like Amazon. When you get from S3, Amazon storage a terabyte, I don't know whether you're getting terabyte or not, because until you use it, they don't need to give you terabyte. They can say, yeah, you have terabyte. So that is like overbooking. Yeah. Which one? The last one?
Yeah.
This is with dynamic, which means it grows with use. So, we already saw several uses of several virtualizations views. So for example, the file system is a virtual view, it's not a physical view. Physically there is no file on the disk. Right? And similarly, the lens and etc., these are all logical. So whenever they say logical, they mean virtual. Right? But the word virtual was not used in the original days, so they call it logical. File systems are also logical and virtual. Thin provisioning is basically also a type of virtualization, overbooking. Another way to virtualize the storage is by RAID. So I have a whole slide on RAID. RAID stands for Redundant Array of Independent Disks. This is the current definition. Redundant Array of Independent Disks. 20 years ago, when it was invented by Berkeley people, okay, Professor Patterson, he was doing research on redundant array of inexpensive disks. So he invented the term RAID. Okay? He took lots of cheap disks and said, look, with lots of cheap disks, I can make a cheaper big disk as opposed to buying a big, cheaper disk, big disk. So it was like this. You buy 10 1 gigabyte disks, they might be cheaper than buying a 10 gigabyte disk. Right? So that is how he was working on, and he came up with this idea of RAID. And now the economy has changed. So now it's not cheaper to buy 10 1 gigabyte disk anymore. It is cheaper to buy 110 gigabyte disk. Alright? But you still need RAID, as we'll see in a minute. And so it is called independent disk. That's all it means. Redundant array of independent disks. Trick. The trick is the divide and replicate data among multiple drives. So the thing is you need your two drives instead of one is because you want to write in two places. If one disk fails, the data is on the second one. Alright, regardless of the cost, you are paying twice the cost, but you are getting some peace of mind. Alright, so that is what it is. And it provides availability, performance, and capacity. So the RAID levels, RAID 0 simply means striping. Now this is the word you have to know, striping. Striping means that you write the first block here, the second block there, the third block here, the fourth block there, the fifth block here, the sixth block there, seventh block here, eighth block there. Why is it good? Because when you want to read, you can read the first block from here and at the same time read the second block from there. So your read speed goes up by a factor of 2. Alright? In fact, your write speed also goes up by a factor of 2. In your writing, you write first block here, the second block there in parallel. Right? So now you are using two disks, but your performance has gone up by a factor of 2. Yeah, so this is the good point. The point is, RAID 0, the word redundant is kind of, you know, not correct. There is no redundancy here. Right? But let's see, you combine with some other things later on. RAID 1 is mirroring. You want to know what mirroring is? Mirroring means that you keep copy. So you mirror. So everything that you write on disk 1, you also write on disk 2. I like to write block 1 here, block 1 here, block 2 here, block 2 here, block. So now you have advantage of the performance, obviously. I mean, performance, the write performance doesn't go up, but the read performance does go up. Right? You can read in parallel. But you have now one more thing, which is the reliability, fault tolerance. If one disk fails, you have a copy. Right? So that is the RAID 1. RAID 1 is mirroring. Now, I said the word without parity. So I didn't explain what parity is. But you get higher read performance. Now let me explain parity. RAID 2 is bit level striping with dedicated Hamming code parity. So first of all, parity bit you should all know is, you know, if you have, when you write 8 bits to memory, in the memory 9 bits are written because there is a parity bit. Right? Even parity or the odd parity. Right? Everybody knows even parity and odd parity. And so that helps figure out if there is any error in the bits. right? Also, if there is no error, if one bit is last, you can figure out what that bit is, because you have 8 out of 9, right? Here, that is what we are using, is that if we put 9 disks instead of 8, then if one disk goes away, we can figure out what that disk had, because everything should add up to even number of ones or even number of zeros. Or odd number, so sorry, even number of ones or even odd number of ones, whatever parity you are using. But then there is a stronger parity called Hamming parity. Hamming code is basically a stronger code than just counting the number of bits. Hamming code is used for error correction and error detection and other things. So that can be put on the disk as well. So you could have 1 bit, 2 bit, 3 bit code. And so basically you add that many more blocks. So you get, instead of 5 blocks, you write 8 blocks, because 3 blocks are parity. Right? So here, I haven't shown the picture here, but you will write A1, A2, and then A3 would be parity. Or actually, I wouldn't call it A3, but I would call it AP, which is A1P, which is parity, something like that. Anyway, so you have parity. So the thing is, if one disk fails, then that happens, right? RAID 3 is byte level striping. This is bit level striping. So bit level striping means you do 1 bit here, 1 bit here, 1 bit here, and the parity bit there. Byte level is you write 1 byte, 1 byte, and parity byte there. Not commonly used. This one is not commonly used. This is not used. So 0 and 1 are the used, 1 used. 4 is block level striping. So you write A1, A2, A3, and then you write a parity. You write B1, B2, B3, and you write a parity. Actually, parity, as you can see, is being, doesn't have to be written in one disk. It could be distributed. So this is shown as RAID 5. In RAID 4, it will be here, but RAID 5, it is basically distributed. So the parities can be anywhere. All right? So the good thing about distributed parity, if suppose this disk went away, or let's say this disk went away, then at least some data you can read. You can read A2, A3, B3, B2, and so on and so forth. Only some parities, 1/4 of the parities will have to be reconstructed. If you have everything on the parity here and then this went away, then everything has to be reconstructed. So just reconstruction time is lower with distributed parity. Yeah, go ahead.
So A2 and A3 are mirrors
of A1? A1, A2 are mirrors of each other?
Are mirrors of A1?
No. There's no mirroring here.
So
it's only parity. There's no mirroring in this picture.
Still not redundant, right?
Huh?
Still, there is no redundancy.
There is redundancy, because parity is redundant.
Oh, okay. But parity isn't it?
Actually, parity is better than replication. Parity is better than mirroring. Mirroring is 50%. Parity could be 20%, 13%, 10%, as much lower overhead you want. So the thing is, if you just take 10 disks and put 1 bit of parity, you get 11, right? As opposed to mirroring, you need 5 and 5.
So how could the parity use to
reconstruct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, simplest example would be just to carry even and odd parity. You know how even parity works? In the even parity, you count the number of ones. They have to be even number, 5 ones. If something goes away and you don't know whether it was 0 or 1, and then you just count it. So 1 bit will, actually 1 bit parity will not let you construct that bit, but what you do is you keep it so that you get 2 bits, and that will indicate you what was the bit that you lost. Maybe you can take a 2-bit example. Take any, let's see. So let's say you want to write 3 bits, and you instead of 3, you write 5. Right? So you have 8 combinations, and then you have 2 bits you have added. So the total 32 combinations. So 32 out of 8 are valid. Sorry, 8 out of 32 are valid. Right? So when you get any 4 of those 5 bits, you can figure out which one is the valid combination next to it. Here is the valid combination. Yes.
So what if the parity is a test problem?
Yeah. Any bit can go wrong. Doesn't matter. As long as you have, see, out of 32 combinations, which includes the parity, you have only 8 valid combinations. And then you, and when you find yourself in any place in this 32-point space, you find out what is the closest valid point, and that is the point. Okay. Not clear or clear somewhat. Basically, I mean, you have to write down 32 combinations. I can do that. But basically, you write down 32 combinations, and then whenever something goes wrong, you find out which is the closest one, you know, generally one bit away from you. Valid one. And that is what, because the two valid ones will be 2 bit away from each other at least. RAID 6 actually has double distributed parity and allows for 2 failed drives. And better for large drives. Nowadays, the drives are very large, terabytes and petabytes and so on and so forth. They are good, looks good, but when they go bad, you really lose a lot of information, and it takes a long time to fix all those problems. So you might as well get one more. RAID 6. All right. So RAID 0, 1, 5, 6, right? RAID 0, 1, and 5 are most common. And then you can combine them, RAID of RAID. RAID of RAID is, you could take RAID 0 and take 2 of them and make RAID 1 out of them. So this will be called RAID 0, 1. You make RAID 0, RAID 0, and then you make RAID 1. So RAID 0 means you stripe, RAID 1 means you replicate, mirror. So you make 2 disks and then make 2 copies and a copy of both the disks. Right? RAID 1-0 is the opposite of that. RAID 1-0, you mirror first, RAID 1 first, A1, A2, A3, copy, and then you stripe. A1, A2, A1, A3, so on. Similarly, RAID 53 would be 5 and 3. So look up what is 5, what is 3, and you will find what it is. Alright, but the only thing you have to remember is that you do the first digit first and the second digit later. Alright, and there are other combinations, and I have given you a homework. Draw RAID 50. Yeah.
I have a question about RAID 4 and RAID 5.
Yeah.
So the difference between RAID 4 and RAID 5 is the way they store the parity.
Dedicated parity. The keyword is dedicated versus distributed. So there is one disk which is with parity. All right, I think that is probably now in the history. RAID 5 is equally good, same number of disks, everything is same, distributed is better. So that's why RAID 4 is not used. Similarly, we said RAID 3 is not used. Only thing which is used is 0, 1, 5. Okay? Alright. Then we move on to synchronous versus asynchronous replications. Every time we say RAID or replication or mirroring or whatever we say, there are two choices. One choice is that you do synchronous, which means that when somebody asks you to write, you write primary copy and you write the secondary copy. Only when the secondary copy is written, then you tell the guy, I have finished the job. That is called synchronous. That is called write, immediate write. There is another thing called delayed write, where you write on the primary, and then you say, okay, I'm done, and then in the background, you write on the secondary. Right? What is the advantage of that? Yeah, it's faster, right? But what is the disadvantage of that? Yeah, if the primary fails, secondary is no good. Right? So you take chances. In fact, when you do even on a single disk on your computer, there is a choice for you to decide whether you want write delay or not write delay. And there are some operating system commands by which you can set up that your disk is delayed write. So what happens is when you write to your disk, it is not written to the disk, it is written to the memory. And at some point, the operating system will write it to the disk. Right? And so you can set up some registry commands which says that whether you want to delay it or not. Delayed write is very fast, but then if you lose something, you may lose the data. Okay? All right. So now we come to Virtual Storage Area Network, vSANs. And ANSI is the standard for it. So there are two ways. First way is we call zones. And zone is actually, you can call it virtualization, or you don't have to call it virtualization, but basically you can divide the, I can't believe it, how fast these things go. So you can say, well, these ports are zone 1, these ports are zone 2, these ports are zone 3, and some ports can be in both zones. So this is basically some kind of, you know, I mean, really more like a physical, well, I mean, there's no physical boundary, but at least there's administratively defined partitions. That is a zone. And then these people will not be able to access these disks, and these people will not be able to do other disks. So basically, this is like keeping the department separate. That you can just do by telling the switches that, okay, this is zone 1, this is zone 2. And in fact, there is something called login server in fiber channel, where when a disk comes up or a switch comes up, it goes to the login server and says, look, I am so and so, and I have just come up. Then it says, okay, all right, you are port number 3, and you know, you are supposed to talk to this zone, and you're part of this zone, and all that. So login server just tells you your what you can do. So, but virtual storage is very similar to VLANs. It came up from the Cisco, and now it is a standard. And it is very similar to VLANs. We won't go into detail, but basically, they have, just like VLANs, there is a thing in the frame which tells you which VLAN it belongs to and where it can go and which port is not allowed and all that. So it becomes more logical rather than physical. And each vSAN, the key thing is that each vSAN provides complete fabric services. So here the problem is in the zones, even though there are three zones, there is only one login server, there is only one name server, and there is only one zone server. And the name server, by the way, is the one that just translates, it tells you the physical addresses for a given logical name. So you share these servers, and therefore if one of those goes down, the whole system goes down. Here, in VLANs, each of them will have their own servers. So each VLAN will have its own name server, login server, zone server. So this is basically true. It looks like a true SAN. Full SAN.
So
go ahead.
Did the vSAN existed before the VLAN?
This is different from VLAN?
Was it there before the VLAN?
No, VLAN was first.
Okay.
So this was borrowed. This actually, I said the story. The story is that VLAN were here, and then the Cisco, who makes networking switches, they got into the fiber channel business, and they said, why don't we do vSAN here? And then ANSI took it over and made it standard. So it's a standard now, but it came from VLAN. So the way it works is now, you could have, this is a physical storage network, you have lots of servers, they're all connected to a vSAN switch. Sorry, not vSAN, a SAN switch, and maybe a router to go to some other types of things which are not as smart, to disk arrays, and to tape libraries and all that. But your physical view, logical view is as follows, is that it is that you have a servers which are connected to virtualization appliance, so each of these server things, they are physically connected to some set of disks here. Right, you can divide, you can connect anything to anything by this device. And this device can be two ways. One is in band or out of band. In band means the data plane will go through the device. So all the data packets have to go through the device. Another one is when the data plane is not goes to the device. The device is simply a name server. When you want to write, it tells you which place you should go to, and then you just go to that place. So you send the data to that place. All right. So the control goes through this namespace route, but the data goes straight. In this case, everything goes through the device. So this could be a bottleneck. So there's in-band and out-of-band. And the people, the companies who make all these storage devices like EMC and other companies, NetApp, IBM, Hitachi, they make different kinds of these virtualization appliances. So the final thing is SAN versus NAS. So everything that we talked about in this, not final, okay, there's more into it. Everything we talked about so far is SAN, Storage Area Network. We didn't say the word Ethernet anywhere. Right? Everything is fiber channel. That is SAN. As soon as you put Ethernet, what you get is a NAS. Network attached storage. So none of you have seen SAN, I suppose, but all of you have seen NAS, right? Is there anybody who has not seen NAS? Right? You connect your device, you connect to a server if you have a server at home, or you connect to some server here or something like that through the Ethernet, and you can reach the remote disk. That is all NAS. SAN would be when you use fiber channel or something like that, which you have not done it, I suppose. So NAS is connected over Ethernet, or the general purpose, which nowadays Ethernet only, and then SAN is fiber channel. So let's talk about NAS. So the first protocol that came up was called iSCSI. iSCSI and uSCSI and BRSCSI. And so the thing is, this SCSI thing was, if you wanted to reach an SCSI device over IP network, then we need a protocol. IETF went ahead and designed a whole protocol, and there's an RFC whose number I have not put here, but you can find it on the Wikipedia page. So iSCSI, there is a protocol. Basically, you can send your SCSI commands over IP, where they will reach a real SCSI device at the end. So to your computer, it looks like you're writing to an SCSI, but there is some driver which sends it over IP. It requires no dedicated cabling because you can go over the internet and uses TCP, and that's the bad part. It requires TCP for end-to-end flow congestion control, and that is very slow. TCP means if one block is lost, which is quite possible, you have to wait for to time out and everything else. And so anyway, but the thing is, it can use the same Ethernet port, you don't need anything. And then there is something called ISNS, Internet Storage Name Service, can be used to locate storage resources. Just like they have name server on the fiber channel, here we have ISNS, which you can look up to see where the disk called X is located. So you reach the disk by its name, but then it has to be translated into an ID at some place, and that is done by ISNS. Then the next one came, Internet Fiber Channel Protocol, where you can connect fiber channel over TCP/IP. And so this is a converter. You take a fiber channel packet and convert into IP packet by removing the fiber channel header, putting the IP header, and sending it to the IP device, so on and so forth. So this becomes just IP data. And so this is a converter. This is also uses TCP. And so basically what you have is IP to IFCP. This is IFCP. It is called Internet Fiber Channel. This guy speaks Internet Fiber Channel Protocol. These devices don't. They're just IP devices. This is the device that converts IP packet to fiber channel and fiber channel to IP. And from here on, the packet will go on the fiber channel all the way to wherever it needs to go. So this is the IFCP port. Then came FCIP, fiber channel over IP. Now, what is the difference? So, fiber channel over IP is tunneling. Now, this is again another thing we teach in 473, tunneling. Tunneling means encapsulation. So, what you do is, when you want to send an English packet through Japan, you put into an envelope, write the address in Japanese, so every Japanese transfer switch or person can forward it, and when it comes out of Japan, you take the envelope out and back into English. Right? That is called tunneling through Japan. Encapsulation, because you put into an envelope and you put the Japanese address on the top, so that's why it is encapsulation. Same thing you could do for the fiber channel thing. You could take a fiber channel packet, put an IP header on the top of it. So the whole SAN header remains inside. Now, once it becomes an IP header, it can go through the IP network wherever it needs to go. Once it comes out, we take out the IP header and we are back to fiber channel. So this is used to connect two fiber channel devices. Both have to speak fiber channel with the IP network in between. Right? So you understand the difference between FCIP and IFCP. If anybody is not clear, then ask now. Here, we take out the header, put a new header, send it on. Now, it cannot come back to a fiber channel device because fiber channel information is all lost.
So, it replaced the IP packet with send header with IP packet.
Okay. Here, the SAN header is saved. It goes to the IP network. Yeah, right. And so now when it comes back, everybody understands that SAN packet. Everybody understand the difference between the two? All right. Finally, we have FCOE, fiber channel over Ethernet. Now, both of the previous ones used Ethernet. Sorry, both of used TCP, and TCP is not very good. So why not just forget the whole IP world? Ethernet can do it all. So we do fiber channel over Ethernet. So maps the FC directly over Ethernet, replaces the layers with the Ethernet. So this is like the first protocol that we talked about. So the headers are replaced and it goes to the Ethernet port and you use it. So this is what is used generally. So today, what you will have in data center is the host may not have any fiber channel port. All right? They will have Ethernet port. The storage will have the fiber channel port, so it will go on the fiber channel. At some point, there will be FCOE switch. It will convert into Ethernet. Now, the only problem with this is Ethernet, so you cannot really go over IP on this one. So if you have two subnets in between the router, that you cannot do. And so this is designed only for one subnet. Virtual file system. So actually, I think we already talked about this, is that the storage access is either block-based or file-based. Now, file systems are also many file systems like NTFS and FAT32. But there are many virtual file systems, which means that the file systems which are located on a different network. And Windows, we call them distributed file system, Windows distributed file system, which means it is not physically on your desk, on your computer, it is on some other computer, but you are accessing it remotely. That is a virtual file system. Windows DFS. Linux also has a DFS, which is Windows implementation. There is an AFS, Andrew file system, from Carnegie Mellon, and named after Andrew Carnegie, who is the founder of Carnegie Mellon. Andrew file system. And then there is a parallel virtual file system, which distribute data across multiple servers to provide concurrent accesses. So this is all just like RAID. The last one is just like RAID, but instead of going physically, you go over a network. So that is the end of this lecture, I think. And the summary is 6 key messages. First is that the SCSI is a common interface used on storage devices. So now you know that. And then there were a lot of other things that are not relevant, which were ETA, SATA, SCON, PyCon. Really, fiber channel is the one which is used in the data center. Right? So that is East to RAID area network. Then we understood the RAID, which allows, you know, RAID is actually, I discussed RAID here because it does give you a virtual view. You think there is one disk, but there are four, five, six disks behind it, right? You think you're writing once, but there are two copies being made. So therefore, I had to put that in. Then there are many NAS protocols, I mean, protocols to go over the network, iSCSI, IFCP, FCIP, FCOE. So you have to know that finer difference between these four protocols. All right? What is the difference? Basically, some use IP, some don't use IP. Some can go back to the SAN, some cannot go back to the SAN. SAN is fiber channel based, NAS is Ethernet based. So now you know clearly the difference between the two. And the virtual file system basically allow you to reach files by the network. Okay? A system which is not really, you know, it could be very different from what you see. So for example, a virtual file system could allow you to look at a disk which is not local, and you might be able to, in fact, some of them, like I don't know AFS, but most likely it does allow you to just fake a NTFS partition, where at the receiving end, it might be stored at some other partition, right? So we don't know what is at the remote end. So that's the end of this lecture. There is no homework. There is a reading list. The third reading you don't have to do because it is not on Safari, but if you can find it, you can use it. There's plenty